So this talk is from my sons, Dante and Leonardo. I still remember the time that my husband told them in the car that I will do a TEDx talk. So my son runs into the house and screams, "Mommy, mommy, this is so exciting." At that point in time, my MSP, mother share price, skyrocketed. Any teenage parents here, you know that your father share price and mother share price is extremely volatile. It's like meme coins, right? So thank you, TEDx, very much for this boost, which was very short-lived, but I enjoyed every second. So I take you back into 1992, into Rohrbach, Upper Austria. I was one of the five of 150 candidates selected to work for Raiffeisen Landesbank Oberösterreich. And I know, it's funny, right? And I grew up pretty spoiled, even though you might think, you know, a girl from communist Czechoslovakia, how spoiled could she be? We had a house, we had a fridge, we had a car, the regime just fallen, my life was hunky-dory. And the last thing I expected to be thrown into a boarding school in Rohrbach and to share a room with 4 hour girls, to share a bathroom with 40 others, and to be forced to pray at lunchtime. My husband, who is from South Africa, would tell me, "Honey, this is a first world problem." But of course, for me at that time, it was an absolute disaster. So what did I do? Like many girls probably and boys in my age would do, I called my parents. I said, "Mom, Dad, this is horrible. My bags are packed. I want to go home. I'm super uncomfortable. I didn't like this. I didn't plan for this. I didn't want this." And my dad, who used to be a professional ice hockey player and a trainer, asked me 3 questions. He said, "Are you safe? You have food to eat? You have a place to stay?" I said, "Yes, yes, yes." So he said, "I see you in a month." And he hung up the phone on me. And that was one of the life's greatest lessons. Because I realized that it's only up to me to push my limits, to embrace change, and to do things differently. So I really want to thank my dad for not jumping into the car and picking me up at that time in Rohrbach. Because giving up is so easy. Walking away, driving away is so easy, especially when it's scary. Looking people in the eye, it's scary, right? So as I went through the process, I discovered, and you might have different number of stages, that when change comes or challenge or new technology, whatever it is, I go through 4 phases. Number one, I hate it until today. It's horrible. Any change comes, believe it or not, I absolutely hate it. I'm yet to meet or believe a person when they say, "I love to change." Then once I get over it, I have a little bit of Germanic brain in myself. I start to plan, you know, tasks, right? Steps, timelines, to-do list, and so on. So once I'm in that stage number 2, I start to really embrace it. You know, I start liking it. Then I'm in stage 3, which is like the embrace stage. I forget that the first stage even existed, and I'm loving it. I go deeper, I learn more, and I'm just thinking, oh, and I've become an expert because I really, really want to do that. So through these stages, I found that I have 3 superpowers. Besides of being mother of 2 teenagers, which I think it's definitely a superpower, but I have 3 other ones. So number 1 is embrace fear. Number 2 is curiosity. Number 3 is consistency. You might ask yourself, how is embracing fear a superpower? Maybe let's start closer to home before we go to AI, right? So I fear aging. Anybody else fears aging? Oh my goodness, that's love. I didn't know so many people will come out. So what do I do? I do Botox, I do fillers. Lately I do face yoga. I fear anxiety and depression. As a woman over 50 in a menopause, anxiety and depression are the names of my older sisters. So I do transcendental meditation. I got really inspired by Arnold Schwarzenegger, who practiced it for 2 years. And I thought, you know, if Arnie can do it, I can do it too, right? And of course, like many people in the room, I think, and around the world, I fear gaining weight. Not only it's not, you know, optically pleasing for me, but it's very unhealthy for your own body. So I lift weights 4 times a week, and I do 10 to 15,000 steps every single day. But my biggest fear of all, is a fear that my skills will be obsolete, that I will have nothing to say. So that's where my second superpower comes in, which is curiosity. So every time I fear something, I started to be really curious, what can I do about it? I read about 40 to 50 books a year. Okay, hold on. If you ask my son Dante, who doesn't count audiobooks as reading, I don't read. Yeah? If you're in my camp, I read. You choose. I mean, in this year's library, I have about 15 books on AI. I have another 5 or 6 books on data, and obviously many more. Because reading really expands your horizon. It trains your brain to expand and to embrace new things. And I could, you know, if I think about it, I told you about 1992, and I think about 1995, where I was the youngest deputy branch manager of a branch in Český Krumlov, and we were just about to open it, and we had only one IT staff. Can't imagine it today, right? So I had to learn how to set up a server room, how to connect computer. It was not my job. So I had two options, right? I would sit and wait, and the opening would be delayed, or I'll learn how to do it. Later on, when I managed 11 markets in Central Eastern Europe for branches for Raiffeisen, I was responsible that all of them looked the same. It was very difficult if we didn't have standards and we didn't have budget. So any architects in the room? Excellent. So obviously you know CorelDRAW, right? So I was in banking, nothing to do with CorelDRAW, right? We had Midas as a core banking system. So I learned and taught myself how to use CorelDRAW. I redraw every single piece of the furniture, from containers to tables to bank counters. Published a CD, if anybody still remembers how CDs look like, and send it to all the markets so they can send it to their suppliers. And I could go on and on, but I think that, you know, a couple of years ago, maybe bring it a little bit closer, about 4 years ago, I got into space, new space economy and space tech. By coincidence, because I really was curious where this $1.4 trillion industry is going. Then I got into sustainability and gaming, and of course AI. And now my third superpower kicks in. You know, I did these things by intuition, but now I do it by habit, and I call it that I take my brain to the brain gym. You know the same way you go to the gym to exercise and you do Pilates and run and do whatever, or meditate? I take my brain to the brain gym every single day. And it's super important, especially today with all the technologies around ourselves. Artificial intelligence, quantum computing, space, Web3, all of these big bubbly words, right? And for women, even triple more important. It depends what report you looked at, but there's only about 20 to 25% women in artificial intelligence. About 10 to 15% of women in blockchain. About 20 to 23% women in space tech, besides of UAE, where I live, which has 50% women in the UAE space agency. So it's really, really important for you to muscle through and to learn and to learn every day. And I want to demystify that I'm in AI for many years. I wish. Yeah? Okay, if I had a time machine, I would go back. I would not go back to 1956 to the Dartmouth conference where AI was created. I mean, that would make me pretty old. Good looking, but pretty old. I would go to 2012 where deep learning was invented, right? Because that's where I think the rock and roll of AI really started. I would go back to learn. But I got into AI about over two years ago when ChatGPT was launched for public. I went, did multiple courses. I went to MIT to do AI course as well for product development in AI. And look at me today. Over the last 15 months, I trained over 2,400 people in AI. And I really made it my mission to bring other people along. So with my team, I forced them, positively of course, positive reinforcement, to do 45 minutes a week session together where we only learn new AI tools. So one person from our team would learn something, some new AI tool, and then he or she would teach the others once a week. Because if you work from 9 to 5, not literally, you don't spend time exploring new things. You don't go to the brain gym, right? And I do the same with my children. So I mentioned I have 2 boys. So last year in October, I sent them on their first AI course. They hated me. My youngest son said, "Mommy, you know, during holidays, if you send us to a course, It's like going to school. It doesn't count as holidays. So as a good Eastern European mother, I imposed a little bit of dictatorship and I'll send them anyway. And after day one, the sparks came up. Within 4 days, they created fake companies, they created products, they tested their concept using synthetic data, they created marketing strategy. My younger son, at that time he was 11, had an idea that you go and you take a picture of your fridge and it tells you what you can cook and what you can do with the leftovers. And I guarantee you somebody was listening to him, because a week later in the GPT store, a sous chef was published, which does exactly the same. As we actually recording this, my children are doing another AI course. This time they didn't protest so much. They obviously knew they didn't have the chance. But yesterday I spoke to them, and my older son was telling me he's working on a project where he's augmenting himself with AI to create technology which will bring debris from space down and recycle the valuable material. My younger son, who is a musician, they both are, but my younger son, who is a musician, was telling me he's working on a solution powered by AI where artists who passed, who are dead, you could use the data from the past to create digital twins so that they can create music and art again. It shows you the power, what's happening right now. And I really want you to think about AI, something which is on number one, a danger to us as human beings, because according to the reports, by 2030, about 800 million jobs will be augmented or automated. That's really scary, right? And I think maybe we can, you know, think about a quote which I really love. So in UAE, since 2017, we have a Minister of Artificial Intelligence. His name is His Excellency Omar Sultan Al Olama. And in Davos this year, he said something which absolutely, you know, stuck with me. I hope it will stick with you as well. He said, there is no definition or perfect definition for the word complete in the dictionary. But if you embrace, and in connection to artificial intelligence, if you embrace artificial intelligence and all which comes about it, you will be complete. If you're a little bit late to the train station and you jump on the train later, you might be finished. And if you completely ignore it and you will do nothing with it, you are completely finished. So I want you to go and I want you to experiment and learn. Build your own GPT. It's not difficult. I built multiple prototypes. One of them was, I call it the Tinder of universities. Nothing with, Tinder, right? It matches university profiles with children, with how they are, what are their personalities, what do they like, what are their capabilities towards universities, and the profiles of it. And second one I was experimenting with was a GPT, which is based on Viktor Frankl logotherapy. Any of you who went to therapy, obviously there's a slightly different way of therapy. It's not a therapy which obviously it's built on your past, but it's built on your present and the future to overcome psychological challenges of depression and anxiety. So go out, try, build your own code, build your own GPT, experiment. It's very, very important that you take your brain to the brain gym every single day. Put 30 minutes in your calendar. You know, if it's in your calendar, it gets done, right? So put it in and learn. And one of the reasons which I'm asking you to do it is, I read a book by Kevin Rose, which is called Future Proof. And Kevin asks this beautiful question in his book. He asks, are you an API endpoint? What does that mean, right? Do you have a current job only because the two systems you're sitting in between can't talk to each other yet? If your answer is yes, or maybe, or partially, you better start to go to the brain gym every day. So I think that it's, you know, really important, especially for women. And I want to inspire the women who are listening to this talk. Go and start your brain gym journey tomorrow or today. Start with artificial intelligence, go into Web3, go into space, everything which you don't know today, which takes you out of your comfort zone, because knowledge is free. And we cannot I say we cannot have this new world only be ruled by men. So, but if I'm very honest, all of this I'm only doing to keep my mother share price up. Because if my kids think that the coolest thing about me is that I have a six-pack and work in AI, that's maybe the best validation I will ever have. Thank you very much.